I'm Grace Farrell, and you're watching the 86th Floor Outlander panel. To be honest, we're still reeling somewhat from the horrific finale that was To Ransom a Man's Soul. In some ways, it's hard to really discuss the episode much further beyond how disturbing the rape and torture scenes were. But you can't deny this episode is an important example of the ways in which content can be transferred from page to screen. It seems like a lot of people thought the series went too far with Randall and Jamie, with other fans saying that this level of depth was necessary in order to show why Jamie is so damaged afterwards. And I think the answer's actually explained in the programme through Claire's inability to understand why Jamie is so mentally broken. She even says to Murta that rape and torture shouldn't be reason enough to make him want to end his life. It's only through seeing and understanding the full extent of the event that allows us to comprehend why Jamie has been affected in the way that he has. Well, we are once again joined by our Outlander experts, Ginger and Summer, hosts of the Outlander podcast. They have, in fact, just returned from their own Scottish Highland adventure, so should be full of inspiration and wise words this week. Ladies, let's begin with that point then. Do you think the episode went too far?
Episode 116, the season finale of season one of Outlander, To Ransom a Man's Soul. So, the rape and torture, did it go too far?
I don't think that it did, and that may be controversial to say, but I honestly think they could have gone further, and given the context of the books and what it could have been, I honestly think it was tasteful, and I think that's a horrible thing to say about rape and torture, that it was tasteful, but I think given the subject matter and given the story that they started with, it could have gone further.
It could have gone further, and when we spoke with Ron, and he said this in other interviews, he said that the way they decide what to do is we know that they likely had more footage, because he was doing it in the editing room, figuring out at which point can I not watch anymore, at which point can I not handle it, and he's like, I use that as kind of a barometer of, you know what, if I can handle it, viewers likely may not be able to handle it, or it's gone too far. So I'm curious, not that we need to see it, but I'm curious how much further they had, how much more stuff they had that they didn't give. But anyway, that's exactly what Ron has said a number of times, that that's his job, to figure out what that line is. In general, to figure out how much of anything, but in something as sensitive as and as important as and as heinous as this, it becomes even more important to be extremely sensitive and delicate with that line. You do have to, you can't pussyfoot around it. You have to show a certain amount. You have to get the point across. There can be no denying what happened and how awful it was and how much blood was
left.
Well,
let's also be honest that it's not supposed to be a comfortable scene to watch. And if it is a comfortable scene to watch, they're doing it wrong.
I wouldn't say doing it wrong. They're not doing enough, maybe, or not including enough. But yeah, I'm
just saying, if you're watching a rape and torture scene and you're like, this is cool, then there's something either wrong with you or they filmed it in a way that was not, not effective.
So I don't think they went too far.
No.
Do I think they could have done more? I mean, in a black and white world, yes, they could have. Do I think they should have? Probably not. I think they did just what they needed to do. And, we do know that, you know, book aside, we do know that even in just the series, in just the script, that more happened than was shown. The example I go back to is when he is telling Claire what happened, saying, it didn't have to describe much, but he says, he made me beg and he made me crawl. Okay, well, we saw him beg at the end, which was started the show, beg to lose his life, please, you know, kill me. And so that was, maybe, there probably was more begging than we didn't see, but also the crawling, we didn't see him crawl. So those are two very small examples, but stuff that made it to the text, to the script, that is mentioned that we don't see. So I am sure they had more, whether it was in the script or just in the script, written dialogue, or just, you know, action, the scene directions that they had to do. I don't know if they'd ever release a director's cut of that, because that was pretty much director's cutty enough.
That makes me uncomfortable just saying that.
Now, we need to talk about Jack Randall. I can't actually think of a more evil character that I've really seen on a TV series than Captain Blackjack. I say seen because obviously there's been characters who've killed on a much bigger scale, but it's rare that we really see the true sickness of these characters laid bare in such drawn-out scenes, especially given the fact that Outlander is essentially a period romance. Ginger and Summer, what did you think of Tobias Menzies' embodiment of Jack Randall? How does he compare to the Randall of the novels?
So, speaking of the rapist and the torturer, Black Jack Randall, played by Tobias Menzies, what did we think of him compared with the book BJR?
I mean, I think he got it. I don't think you could really have asked for anything more from the person cast as BJR. Mm-hmm. He horrified me, mm-hmm. he terrified me, and he has traumatized me for probably the next few months. Like, I can literally hear him telling Jamie to scream in a silent room. Like, if it gets too silent in a room, I hear echoes of him telling Jamie to scream.
That was uncomfortable, but I just look at, I mean, just, we've seen it in every single episode with BJR. Though just the way his posture is, the way he walks, quite frankly, with or without clothes. No, seriously, it's just the way his posture, the way he walks, is just, he holds himself a certain way, and whether it's walking across the room or what, it doesn't matter. He embodies this to the pinky.
The pinky?
Yeah.
Is that a new
to
phrase?
To his hand, to the tips of his fingers. He just fills out, like if you imagine the character as like a blow-up doll or as like a big balloon, he fits every, like a glove, he fits himself into every nook and cranny of that and embodies whatever that is. And I've been a fan of his since Rome, and he always does this, that's just his acting, but there's something, it's gonna sound odd, there's something special about BJR in that, not that's a positive thing, but or special about his portrayal of him. He, it's down and dirty like I've never seen another villain. I mean, it's just, it's awful, but it's tremendous and kind of an honor to watch.
Well, his willingness to completely become that character and go in those places, and the same for Sam Heughan. I mean, the scenes in this episode were horrific. Mm-hmm. They were heart-wrenching. They were heartbreaking. Yeah. They were just, like, so awful. And they just, they made all of those things real, and you could just see that they were 100% invested in those moments in the scene, and that honestly probably made it harder to watch. But
now, what about the BJR played by Tobias in the series and the BJR in the novels? What how do those compare? I think obviously in the novel, since you're making your own image in your mind about.
The only difference that I could tell you off the top of my head between the BJR of the novels and the BJR of the series is that the BJR of the novels has blue eyes. Other than that, they're both heinous and horrible people.
So, eye color aside, that, I mean, he, like I said, he embodies it. I don't know how someone could, it's going to sound really odd, I don't know how an actor could play that role any better. I mean, there may be some people out there who can do it just as well. They may not want to now that they've seen what the role is, but I mean, I like I said, to the pinkies, to the tips of his fingers, he just embodies this character in an awful and wonderful way.
Now, a big theme in this episode was religion and souls. It's no coincidence that they end up seeking refuge in a monastery after Jamie's ordeal, especially since religion really hasn't been referred to at all before now. Murta draws attention to the fact that Jamie isn't getting any better in the churchy environment, but then ultimately it's Jamie's very Catholic act of confession to Claire that finally brings him a bit of peace. I'd go as far as saying he's kind of likened to Jesus in the episode, firstly with the nail in his hand, and then with the image of him in a sort of white loincloth lying beneath the cross. I mean, is Jamie actually Jesus? Is that what is happening now with Outlander?
One thing I didn't really get, though, was Claire's readiness to open up to the monk about her own past, particularly her time-travelling stuff I thought that was a bit weird. Now, another issue people have had with the episode was Jamie's unfeasibly speedy recovery at the end. Ladies, what did you make of this?
So, Jamie's recovery. Mm-hmm. There's been some talk online, some dissension in the ranks, kind of, some disagreements about the realistic nature of Jamie's recovery, that perhaps it happened really fast.
Well, okay, if you remember some of the last scenes when they're on the boat and Claire's near the edge and he walks over to her, he's kind of walking kind of carefully, his hands all bandaged, he's not moving very fast. He's got soreness in places.
Oh, we're not talking about that recovery.
I understand that.
Okay.
So, his physical recovery, his demeanor, he is obviously tortured still, which we'll find out later, but we'll see more, hopefully, in season two, but with the announcement of the pregnancy and everything, he brightens up, he finds happiness again, sooner than he thought he could have, but what I'm trying to say is, His physical recovery is not done. It's not complete. He's still kind of going in there.
But I don't think that's even what we're talking about here.
Well, there's two kinds. So there's the physical, which we can see from the way he's walking and the way he's everything, is not done. That takes his time. His spiritual or inner...
Seriously.
His spiritual or inner recovery... is, and maybe not spiritual, but his inside.
We're talking his PTSD issues.
Yeah.
His PTSD issues. And I think that the problem that a lot of people are having is the fact that in the course of 1 5-minute scene, he goes from saying, I don't want to live, I can't live this way.
And get the F away from me,
you
Claire.
Need to, I can't be your husband, and I won't be anything but that, basically like.
Anything less than that.
Yeah. Exactly. So he goes from that to all of a sudden going, okay. Maybe I can live. We'll try this again. And I can see that, but I also see that there was a moment that they had in that scene where Claire was... I think, and we mentioned this in our podcast this week, is that I think he deep down thought that if he let her go and told her to leave and that he could not be her husband, that she would go back through the stones to her own time. And I think that the moment he realized that, no, if I'm not with you... I'm going to die here and we're going to die together. And he was like, wait, so if I die, she's going to die too. I think that at that moment, it was almost like he's like...
He wakes up a little bit.
He wakes up a little bit and he also, finally, he had something to live for a little bit when he realized that he was what she had to live for and he needed to be there to help her to move forward with that.
And similarly, it's very close along the same vein, but also I could understand how book readers would, having read it where the scene is, it's much more drawn out, it's longer, it's more rough and tumble, I don't want to say it's more believable, but that's what, if you're a book reader, that's what you have, that's your schema of the story, that's the thing against which you measure it, rightly or wrongly, it is just that way. And so coming into it, having the rough and tumble be like for 5 or 6 seconds, and then a conversation, and then him like breaking and saying, okay, I can do this. It was so far apart from how it was. It had like bits of it, but it was so quick. I think that's the gist of what, kind of what we've talked about and what we've read a lot of people are feeling. And I completely understand. I would have liked a little more, but again, we want more of everything. This is Outlander. We want all the bits.
What I like to point out is that if you get back, I think the week before the episode aired, the writer, Diana Gabaldon, got online and said basically to all of my readers, just step away from the book.
Step away
from the book.
Put the book down.
Put the book down. Walk away from it and just watch the episode and enjoy the fact that it is basically a completely different entity. That book will always be there. You can always go back and read it again for all those bits that you love, but step away for the sake of the series. So I think if you can do that, you're probably ahead of the game.
So, happy Outlander finale.
Enjoy your Droughtlander.
Enjoy
the hiatus.
Enjoy the hiatus, and hopefully we'll see you back for Dragonfly and Amber, Outlander Season 2.
Personally, I didn't think it was too quick, since he does make it clear that he's still struggling inside when he cracks that joke about the sick bucket on the boat. But he's obviously just making more of a conscious effort for Claire. I think Randall will continue to haunt Jamie well into the second series, but exactly how remains to be seen. So now we look to season two, where it seems that Claire's objective has progressed from merely surviving in her new time to actually changing the future. Obviously, changing the future carries all sorts of risks and repercussions, so I can't wait to see how this storyline develops. What did you think of the final episode of Outlander? Do let us know in the comments below and hit the subscribe button for more fan-based videos about all things fantasy. A massive thank you to Ginger and Summer for their contributions this week. Remember, you can listen to the Outlander podcast online and follow them on Twitter and Facebook. Until next season.